Thank you all. Thank you. Good afternoon. Sorry for being late. My talk was scheduled in the morning, but I had some delays with the trains, so here I am now. Thanks for the organization for setting this up. So I'm Jan de Vries. I work for a small consulting company based in the Netherlands. Over there, I'm called a cloud solution architect, which means I get to talk a lot about cloud solutions and voice my opinion. I'm also a Microsoft MVP on the Azure stack, which means I also do a lot of stuff in the community and hearing my letting my voice known about stuff. So my experience is mostly in Azure, but today's talk is global for all cloud providers or not even on premises. First question to you all is, who of you works at Netflix, Spotify? I know there's some Amazon guy over here, but I don't know if he's in this session. So, but how big are your teams? Any people over here working in a company with 100 plus development teams? One. Oh, no. Anyone with 50 plus development teams? Who of you works in a company with 10 or less development teams? Oh, that's less as I imagined. So, but most of the times we work at companies who don't have a lot of development teams, and most of the times the teams are rather small. Most companies I see have like 50 to 60, maybe 80 developers and testers in their company, and they're doing their own thing, sometimes working together, sometimes not. But the question is, does every team want to maintain its own piece of software, or do you want to maintain the software across all of the teams? Most of the times, our companies are small enough, or luckily small enough, we have to do development across the whole stack of solutions we're creating, a whole stack of software we're creating. So one day you're working on the front end, second day you're working on the back end, next day you're working on some kind of message broker you invented yourself. Happens, or at least in the teams I've worked in, this happens. We have to maintain like 40, 50, 60 services, solutions with, well, we have 5 teams now. So we have a lot of software running somewhere and we have to maintain this all. So why do you want to go the microservices path? Most of the time, scaling comes to mind, which is a good reason why you would go microservices. Some people say, well, you have the freedom to do whatever you want in each solution you're creating. So you can start out with Ruby, Java, C Sharp, PHP. Every service can implement their own development environment. You can even implement your own different software designs inside your solution. So someone might like the N-layer solution, someone else architecture. Someone else might like an onion architecture in their project. It depends which one fits best, of course, but do you want to maintain all of these technology stacks inside your organization? Most of the time, that's not a very good idea because you have to keep up to date with all of the knowledge and all of the updates of all languages, design patterns, stuff which fails, logging, how to share logic. So that's hard. So that's not a good idea to start with microservices. Only if you need the scalability, it might be a good idea. That's why I love the monoliths, the plain old-fashioned monoliths, like one big executable deployed on a server, and it runs. If something is failing, the whole application is failing, and we know it's failing, and we know how to fix it, just double-click the executable file or a jar file or whatever, and it runs again, most of the time. it's robust, it stands the ages of time, and it's been, well, most of us probably have to maintain some monolith solution which started the development like 10 years ago and is still running. All of the microservices solutions I've come across with have been refactored, thrown away, whatever, within 3 years. So that's a microservice solutions I've come across with, well, a couple, are rather fragile. There is only one thing which, well, has to happen, like a big blow in the wind or some trembling, and it all falls apart, like a big Jenga tower. Of course, you can also design your monolith like this. A lot of pieces stuck together, glued together, and if you pull out one thingy, everything will fall down eventually. So monoliths, as we know them at the moment, most of the time aren't very well designed and you don't want to maintain it. That's why most people don't like monoliths nowadays. But if you do it correctly, design your monolith correctly, it's a joy to work in because it's simple. You don't have to think about all of the complexities added to a microservices architecture. Only if you design it right. How should you design this? Well, a lot of smart people have talked about this and have voiced their opinions. And now it's my turn. Not that I'm smart, but I just read what they have spoken out. So how should you design your system? Like a silo. Each and every functional piece of logic inside your application should be designed like a big silo. It has an entry point and it has an output, and all of the stuff happens within. It doesn't have any shared logic within other silos, within other pieces of logic inside your solution. If you design your monolith like this, it's a joy to work with. It's also easy to pull out one of the silos, one of your functional domains, and put it inside some separate service, because it doesn't have any dependencies within other boundaries of your system. So you can just pull it out, put it in a web service, and be done with it. It can scale infinitely, if you're putting it in a serverless environment, of course. So that's how you should design your monolith, and microservices for the matter. One of the first microservices designs I've come across with, it was a couple of years back, one of my customers called me, "Hey Jan, I have a problem, or I want your opinion on our design, because we've created something and it's going to production next month, so you have to say it's good, because we're going to production." Okay, our company does quick scans for 1 day or 2 days, and we get flown in. We see the code base. We do some. We voice our opinion on the code base and the overall design, and write some document and go away. Sometimes we even get a consultancy job out of it later on. Sometimes not. But what they had created, and I had to say, this is good stuff, was this. It's a rather evil design what they had created. Because if you pay attention to the different services they had created, they're just table entities. This is just the database model, service-fied, or whatever it's called. That's not an English word. So whenever they wanted to get a customer in their page, they also had to do a REST call to a person, or the customer service had to do a call to the person service, because you probably want to know the first name of your customer, and you might even want to know where he works or she works, stuff like this. So this was a big mess, to say the least. And they were so proud of this, because we're doing microservices. Yeah. They were doing services all right, and they were rather small, but this is not how the microservices pattern works. So I had to say, well, so what did I do? I told them, well, it's a suboptimal solution. It has one business value, which you can sell to your business. You can sell performance as a feature. You could decide just when customers complain, performance is slow, you could just decide just to do SQL queries inside the database instead of doing REST calls between your services. So you can sell performance in 6 months of time and tell them, well, we've improved our services with 1,000% or something. Some other approach where I was a bit more involved in, and I did it wrong also, was this. We had a couple of small services, each doing their own little thing, but they all landed inside our big relational database. Which is also kind of an anti-pattern, because if something changes on this big database, you could affect one or more services dependent on your tables or views or procedures, whatever you're exposing to the outside. So this isn't a very good idea, having a shared database across your services. And this is what we did. We're still feeling the pain on this, and we now know better now. So how did this design look like a bit? Well, we started out with a couple of APIs, a shared database, and of course, every proper architecture diagram needs some kind of identity and security mechanism. So we had an identity service which does stuff. These weren't just our own APIs. We also had SharePoint, SAP, some other third-party clients like Salesforce, all connecting to our database or our APIs. So this worked ish. And then our customers or our business partners wanted to get to our data. And we were smart enough to know we don't want to expose the SQL database to our partners because that's, well, a big boo-boo. So what did we do? We created some kind of an integration API. You could also strike these words with BizTalk, but we created our own because that's what you do as a development team. And create a public business API. And to this public business API, our business partners could connect to and retrieve data from our database, but also from our internal APIs like SharePoint, SAP, Salesforce, whatever. And we were very proud of ourselves because we had a new public business API, which we could was a single entry point in our system, and we could leverage all of the data or retrieve all of the data from over there. And well, this worked. It's still working, and it's working quite nicely so far. Then a couple of partners were so happy with this this new public business API. They did a lot of requests, so they were kind of DDoSing our system. So we thought, well, we need some business logic for this. So we created a new service, a business management API, so we could throttle business partners. We can even now say you can't access the customer endpoint, or maybe you can just get on the customer endpoint, but don't do any posts. So we were pretty smart, happy with ourselves. We even thought of, well, let's not do this management stuff in our customer databases because it has nothing to do with customer data. So we did a new database because someone, somewhere along the lines we read, each service needs a different database. A new SQL database was introduced. And this is still working, still fine. And because we like to drink our own champagne, of course, we also want to use this public business API. Because if we have problems with this business API, our partners probably will have this also. And somewhere along the lines, a product owner came to us and he told us, well, we want to retrieve data from a bank. And this bank has the data on some FTP site, and we have to retrieve it and put it in our own system. Okay, cool. So we created three different services because we also read each and every single microservice needs to do one thing and do it well and be small. So what we did, we had to retrieve a file from an FTP site. So we created a web job for this. This was every night at 3 a.m. This was published for us, so we retrieved it at 4 o'clock. Stored it in a SQL database because reasons. And then we sent a message to our parse API, which then had to parse the data because, as you all know, or probably know, banks send data, or every third party sends data in a format you don't understand. So you have to parse it in a format you want to have in your system. So that's what we did in this parsing API. We did some string concatenation, some mapping rules, stuff like this. And this works quite nicely. The results were pushed back to SQL Server. And a message was sent to, or an request was invoked on the process API, which in its turn retrieved the records from the SQL database and pushed it to the public business API, so it can get processed inside our different systems, like our customer database, SharePoint, Salesforce, whatever. This works, but as I just told you, if services share one database, it's actually not a very good idea to have this. You could say these three services are one service or one monolith because they're sharing one database. That's not all. If this processing API is failing for some reason, because it's the cloud and stuff fails all the time, the parsing API and the web job API also are failing because they make synchronous calls to the next service. We didn't have a message broker in between. So this is just a monolith distributed, a distributed monolith. If you look this up on Wikipedia, there's an article on this. It's called Big Ball of Mud. That's the official term, apparently. But that's not all. What happens if the integration API is failing? The whole solution is failing if the integration API doesn't work for some reason. If the integration API returns an internal server error, for reasons unknown, the public business API will throw an exception. Process API, parse API, web job will all throw an exception because they're waiting on each other. So we didn't just create a small distributed monolith, but we actually had a massive distributed monolith. And these aren't all the services we have. There are like 40, 50 more, all intertwined with each other on different levels. So this is becoming quite a problem, all because we thought we were doing microservices, or at least we were doing small services. Microservices pattern isn't something we did over here. But there's a different problem over here, which is more serious if some error occurs. Logging. Stuff breaks, mostly at night. And most of the time we're using some kind of logging mechanism. A request comes in, we start a logging information line, executing handler, executing command, do some stuff, and executed command or request, whatever. So the beginning and end probably scoped via some logging mechanism you have in place. But what you have over here, because it's three different services, five different services connecting with each other, you have five different logging groups, because each, scope of your logger, I don't know how it's handled in Java, but in C#, most of the time you have a logger which is injected inside your dependency injection scope, and it has some logging instance ID. And you log this inside your database. Now you have five. This is a problem if something happens, because this is how this would look like inside your logging database. You have several logging groups, each logging their own little thing with some datetime and maybe some other meta information. But there's no way to correlate logging group one to logging group two. You can do some fuzzy logic by mixing and matching the records by datetime, which isn't a very good practice, because you could have multiple requests entering your service at the same time. It happens on the internet. So this is useless. If you get called out during some DevOps call, the service is down, what happened? Well, I don't know. I see there's an exception in logging group 700. But I don't know how it came there. So, good night. So this isn't what you'd want to do. So how do you solve this? Well, design your stuff in silos. Each business action what you want to do should be segregated from the rest of your system, which means you'll get a big command handler or request handler doing all of the stuff, but everything is inside one request handler, command handler, whatever pattern you're using, controller. Everything is happening over there, and of course with some dependencies to other classes and stuff like this, but everything is happening inside the same logging group, inside the same service, component, module, whatever you're calling it, inside your solution. So this looks a bit like this. If you want to do something with invoices, you head to the invoices component and do the stuff over there. If you need to do a purchase, you'll do it in the purchase component, purchase service. Vendors, the same. And of course, I also live in the real world. I know stuff, data, has to be shared between the services. How do you do this? Well, what we did, the big anti-pattern, we were doing communication between these silos. But do you see any pipes running in the real world with real silos running between them? No, that's for a reason. Because you want to isolate them. So how do you communicate with them? Well, you can walk around on the floor. You can send messages between your services, between your components, via some kind of event bus, service bus, message bus, whatever it's called next week. So each and every single data point which has to be, or which could be picked up by some service, will be published inside your event bus. So some people say one big benefit of isolating your stuff like this is you can implement different repositories which make sense per service, per component. So for invoices, it might be useful to have a relational database. For purchases, maybe a NoSQL database. And for vendors, if you have a lot, maybe Elasticsearch Elasticsearch will make sense. I don't think so, but it could be. I don't think you should do this, because just because you can doesn't mean you should. But you have the power to do so if it makes sense. Because there are no dependencies between these services, so it doesn't matter if some service is storing it inside a NoSQL database and the other in a relational database. Still, I'm a big proponent for having one tech stack and keeping it simple, so keeping it with this one tech stack, unless there's a good reason to step off of this tech stack. Also, this comes down also to the software design. You can change it between your components if you want to. Like I mentioned, you, in one service you can do an N-layer architecture. The other you might want to do onion architecture. One other you might want to do start on line 1, end on line 10,000. You could do this. Still, it might be useful to keep it on the same tech stack. But if you're not sharing any data, any business logic, you will probably get a lot of duplicated code. That's true. And what we have been taught the past decades, I guess, I'm not that long in the business, only 1.5 decades, but what I've been taught from school is duplicated code is bad. If you see one line duplicated twice, or at least 3 times in your code base, you should abstract it away in some kind of base class, some kind of helper, some kind of whatever, and make sure there's only one line of code or block of code which is used everywhere. And that's what I've done the past couple of years. Which means I now have solutions with thousands of interfaces, a lot of composition in my classes, and whenever a junior or medior or new senior developer joins my team, they have to spend like 1 to 6 months on-ramping time to understand what the is happening over here. I was in a solution a couple of years back where I was one of the junior developers, or major, depends on who you're asking. HR department, I told them I was major. My colleagues, I said I was junior. For reasons, of course. But what we had over there, we had an on-ramping time of 3 months before someone could do something useful, which is a lot of wasted time. And if we had a bit less abstraction and a bit more duplicated code, the on-ramping time could maybe be 1 week, just to know where your code has to live, where your code belongs, and, well, get started. Sure, if there's a bug in your code, you have to fix it 20 times. Happens. And as with everything in our field, it depends on what you should duplicate and what you shouldn't. Sure, tax rules, it might be useful to share it across multiple components because they're rather universal. Storing first names and last names and, well, identity information, you can duplicate this because, like in the earlier diagram, I had vendors, but what if I also want to have customers? Well, the first name and the last name of vendors and customers looks rather the same. It looks like a person object, which I can store and share between my services. But do they always change at the same time? Not per se. The customer could get a middle name at some point in time and the vendor not, because we don't want to know the middle name of a vendor. Makes sense. So this stuff doesn't change together, so it's not true duplication. It's just, it looks like duplication. And what this all comes down to is you want to get stuff done. That's what we're being paid to do. We're not getting paid to do the most awesome architecture and code delivery there is. We get paid to get stuff done, to get money for the business, to get the product owner happy, to automate the stuff away which is boring, get stuff done. And that's what you can do if you don't have the 3 months onboarding time, or whenever there's some bug, you have to investigate dozens and dozens and dozens of unit tests because they're failing if you change one line of code, which happens in production systems. If you just duplicate the stuff and ship it, unless there's a failing test, of course, you can ship it much faster and focus on each silo. If you have a bug or a new feature inside a purchases system, you can just test the purchases system, create some unit tests, create some integration tests, ask your tester to do some end-to-end test, and ship it. And if it fails, no problem. It's just the purchases element of your solution which is failing. The rest isn't dependent on this, so can just operate like it used to. You know nothing will fail. Well, maybe the purchases component, but well, then we'll just update it 5 minutes from now with a fix. So this is what we came up with, and because I'm an architect, I don't draw these diagrams. I draw physio diagrams, because that's what architects do: draw blocks and lines. And I was quite happy with this, and the team had developed it, shipped it, and then a product owner or stakeholder, I don't remember, came to us and told me, "Jan, this stuff is great. It's running awesome. But I'd like to know who our customers are, because we don't know who they are. We just have invoices, purchases, and vendors. But who's buying this stuff we have? Well, I don't know. This wasn't in the original request you sent to me, so this isn't designed. But back to the drawing board. 3 months later, I came up with this. A new service called Customers. And we can store customer stuff inside this. Of course, using serverless, because we want to scale globally. So draw on an Azure function for this, which is now a customer service, or at least the input element of our customer service, and store stuff in a NoSQL database. And I was done, emailed this diagram to the development team and told them to create this stuff and be done with it. That's how easy you can extend systems which are totally isolated from each other. Just add stuff and read from the message bus. And you only add stuff which is interesting for your customers, because the stuff is interesting because they see a problem, they see we're missing something. Oh, okay, we'll just add it. And messages are already sent to this message bus, because each and every system sends messages to this bus whenever something happens. So if you want to extend functionality, like for example, if an invoice is sent, I'll just send an invoice sent message to this bus, and I can pick this message up in the customer's service in order to reflect this in the customer database. Customer Jan has now created 2 orders in the period of 1 year. I can aggregate all of this stuff in the customer database. So whenever I want to show an overview of my customer profile somewhere on the website, I can just do a select star from database where name is Jan, and show this on the page. I don't have to do difficult inner joins, outer joins, REST calls, wait for events to happen, wait for other services to return, do some circuit breaking stuff. No, I'm just isolated inside my little block over here called customers and can do whatever I want over here. So that's easy. When you have such a design, this is easy to work with, implement, and extend. But as with all, designing stuff is rather hard. So I joked around, it took me 3 months to draw this block. But it will take you some time to come up with such design. Which are the boundaries in your system? Where can you create these lines of these silos? Because does it make sense to create a person silo, or do you want to make this more fine-grained and create customers and vendors and whatever? So coming up with such designs is hard. And when you have come up with this design, implementing the stuff is easy. It's just create 3,000 lines of code, ship it, and be done with it. And you never have to look to it again, unless there's a bug. But then you create just a new service, because you can just hook on to the messages which are already sent and destroy the old service whenever you want to. So your services can be made idempotent also. But design is hard. That's why architects get paid this much. What does this also bring you, such a design? Well, easier deployments. Like I mentioned, if you do an update on the purchase service, the Defender service. If I update Defender service, I know for a fact my Invoice service will not break because I'm updating my Defender service. That's good to know, because now I can update this Defender service 1,000 times per hour without breaking the whole site. Just the Defender component might be a bit slowish because of all of the jitting going on in the back end. But that's easy, and you know nothing will break. Or at least shouldn't, because testing is easier, because you can oversee the consequences of your actions. You don't have to think like, well, if I change this line in this abstract base class, which lives inside this core framework solution, would I break something somewhere? Probably, because it's there for a reason. But you can't oversee this, or at least not easily, unless you have all of the stuff inside one big service, component, module, whatever you're calling it. Also, logging and monitoring will become easier with this. Because logging, like I mentioned, you can just start the scope of your logger, and whenever your scope is done, well, your action is done also. You're always inside one logging group. What I forgot to mention is some people might say, hey Jan, we have a smart development team. We've come up with a solution which is called a correlation ID. And we send out a correlation ID whenever we do a request to a different service. And that's a solution indeed, in order to mix and match logging lines and requests between services. But it's a hack. In my opinion, it's a hack because your design is stupid. If your design wasn't this stupid, you didn't need this hack in order to overcome some technical difficulty you have when doing some back-end logging log queries. Of course, correlation IDs still have value, but they shouldn't have value for you as a developer in order to do problem solving. Correlations IDs should be used for the business in order to investigate how a user is navigating through the site, what the user is doing. So to correlate, well, all of the requests, all of the stuff a user is doing. So adding value, a correlation ID should add value to your business, not to your stupid design. Also, same goes for monitoring. If the Defender service is down, like I mentioned, I know the rest of the website or web application will still continue to run. But I also know if the Defender component is red on my monitoring tool, well, so be it. I'll just add this to the status page of my website, my web application, my whatever tool you have, telling the users the Fender component is down at the moment. We're working on it. Maybe they don't even notice it because you can deploy it 5 minutes from now. If you have a tightly coupled system and some service is down, you haven't got a clue what other services are down also. Well, maybe based on your experience, you might have, because if you're working long enough for the same company or project, you know if some service is down, these other five services are down also. But that's just experience and not something you want. You just want isolated cases of stuff which is breaking. Still, this is all fun and games, of course, but we live in the real world, and there's no such thing as perfect solutions. I still value pragmatic solutions over perfect solutions. I'd rather have a team ship a suboptimal solution today than a team trying to perfect their solution in the upcoming 3 months and still not having delivered value for our customer. So I just ship this crappy software. There are some quality gates, of course, but just ship it, and we'll just tune it during the next couple of weeks, months, when we see if users are actually using the new service and how they use it. Because you might spend time, you might spend a lot of time perfecting your solution for, well, stuff which only happens once or twice per year. We have some analytics in our logging now, and whenever a product owner comes up with a new feature request, hey, Jan, I want our customers to have this and this functionality because it has to change, because we want to do something with it, I'll just do a select star from our logging database. How many users are actually using this component? If it's only two from the, I guess we have like 3.5 million users now, give or take. If there are only two users using it, or maybe even 100 users, does it make sense to spend valuable developer effort to this small feature? Because we can also spend this developer effort, this time, to features which are used across all of the users, or at least a lot of the users. Still got time. I also came across some other guy at a meetup I attended, and they also had this solution design which I'm showing over here. So all segregated pieces of software, and they're doing a CRM software. They're doing CRM software, and what they had in the end were like 400 or 500 different services. And 300 of those services want to know the first name and the last name of, well, the user, the customer. So what they did is they had, well, each service had their own database, because that's what you do. So they had 300 databases containing records with first name Jan and last name De Vries, and first name Hank and last name Pieterman, whatever. So they thought, well, of course, this is by the book, and this is how we should do it. It's the perfect design, but it doesn't feel right replicating all of this data to all of these services. So what did they do? So they were busy with it, and they already had it in place, but they refactored it to a more suboptimal solution, which is the pragmatic approach. They introduced one SQL database, of course replicated because the cloud, and you do this in the cloud, but one SQL database with the personal data, so one table with personal data, and they created 300 different views, each view for one this single service, which could do a select on it. So service one, did a select on view 1. Service 2 did a select on view 2. So they did share the main personal data inside, well, this big massive database. But they segregated this kind of via views. So whenever the database, the table was changing, they knew the services wouldn't fail because the data model of the services would still work. Unless the views break, but that's a different problem, of course. But that's choices you can make, and that's all of the stuff. It depends on what you want to do, but that's stuff you can do once you get on this kind of designing your system. So a lot of good stuff, but it is hard to come up with this and to maintain it and, what is good, what is bad. So that's hard. So that's all for me for now. If you have any questions or want to contact me later on, I have some GitHub repository, Twitter, email, weblog. But if you have some questions now already, I will be happy to answer it.
Do you have some questions that you would like to ask?
Sorry. It's more like a remark that in yesterday and today and even before in other conferences, people say about monoliths and microservices in a very about microservices in a very sarcastic way, but nobody praises either of the two. And you're probably one of few who I heard that actually say, "Hey, let's build monoliths."
So start out with monoliths because that's easy, because that's why I asked the first question. Most of us work in a small company and we are probably happy if we have, a couple of thousand users, which is something a normal monolith will easily scale to. You can even replicate to a different instance and replicate it horizontally if you do it correctly. So a monolith is easy. Microservices are frigging hard. That's why we have these conferences telling you what you should do when you go down the microservice path. You have to take into account network latency, circuit breakers, transient errors, security, logging. I can go on, but a lot of stuff you have to think about. So start out with microservices, and if you start out with monoliths, and if you do them correctly, it will be easy to pull them out. But only do it if it's necessary, and don't pull out everything like you see on a lot of talks or a lot of sales vendor pitches. Because, I'm in the Azure space, and each time Microsoft brings out a new service, they tell you, just pick out this block from your solution and just put it in our new service because it's shiny, and everything will be good. That's of course possible, but most of the time your current monolith solution doesn't support this, so you can't go down this path. So this only goes if you design your monolith correctly, and that's hard with a brownfield application, of course, because most of the time those aren't designed properly, or at least not like we want to nowadays. But if you're in a new greenfield project, please start out with a simple monolith because it's much easier to ship and deliver value to your customers.
Another question?
So I have a question about the solution that you're happy about with the moment that you started to separate the databases with the services. So when exactly the data asynchronization between databases are happening? Technically, like you get this example with the users that has some orders, and you wanted to aggregate it. And
so
the
question
keep it
is,
separately.
So if I understand correctly, your question is, how do I share my data, or how do I replicate my? How does it happen technically? How do I send this data to the different services? Well, what we do now is we send a message to the message bus, something has happened. I've worked at two projects with this design. And in one project, we sent out the full DTO, or the full view model, or object entity, to the event bus, and each and every service could pick this up with each and every field in it, of course with a version, because there's this thing called you can get messages out of order. So you have to specify a version for each field of each object, depends on what you like. So that's what we did, and that works quite nicely. And what we're doing now at the customer I'm working at is we're sending out a smaller event to this message bus, like this and this has happened, with some type and name, identity, correlation ID, etc. And whichever service wants to react upon this, picks this message up, and makes a REST call to the service which which it knows the data lives in. So if a person has changed, if a username has changed of a customer, so we push down a username changed event to some kind of subscription, to some kind of topic on this bus, pick it up, and let's say, for example, my profile service wants to know something about this. It makes a REST call to the customer service and retrieves data. I'm not very happy with this solution, but it does make the bus more lightweight and easy for extensibility, but it depends what the best solution is in your scenario. You have to figure this out, but there are multiple ways you can implement this, and there's no wrong way, there's just different ways.
Okay, so we are end of times. Please give Jan de Vries a warm hand of applause. Thank you.
Thank you.